Let me introduce you. You are you have the paper Empowering Sustainable Supply Chain Management Practices in Hospitality Industry. Authors Daniel Adrian Gârdan, Iuliana Petronela Gârdan, Claudia Gabriela Baicu, Daniel Constantin Jircoveanu.
And that's all.
The colleagues from my university and from Institute for World Economy and Bucharest University of Economic Studies, Faculty of Management. Please, Daniele.
Yes. I put the presentation on screen.
But we don't see it.
You don't see it?
Maybe scroll a little. Okay, it's okay.
It's okay?
It's okay.
All right.
It's okay.
So we have prepared a title that is actually a very important topic in many economic circles. We are dealing with sustainable development in the field of hospitality industry. There are some objectives that we have mainly conducted with our research. Actually, we are talking about a systematic review in a kind, and we have been analyzing important sources from Web of Science between 2017 and 2021. We have searched for articles in the field of sustainable supply chain within the hospitality industry, sustainable human resources management, and so on. And doing that, we have closely followed some guidelines, preferred reporting items for systematic reviews and meta-analysis that are well known in the field of researches such as. And we have included in our analysis publications using the following criteria. First of all, there are publications indexed in Web of Science databases. Only original research papers or reviews, ranges between the years that I already told, and the specific scientific topics taken into consideration. Here we have a table with the main sources that we have found. Actually, when we are dealing with our paper title, we have seen that we can talk about these issues here: green tourism, sustainable hospitality industry, hospitality green supply chain management, hospitality sustainable strategy, and in the last, hospitality green human resource management. All these concepts are interlinked and all together can give us a clue about how it is possible to implement actually green supply chain management into the field. In order to do so, I should pass in a synthetic way into the concepts that we have found. First of all, we have to speak about green tourism. Generally, green tourism is concerning with implementing sustainable principles and practices in all the activity that is underlying tourism. And we can talk about sustainable strategies of tourist-based companies and destinations. These strategies actually are reflecting the growing environmental concerns that influence the behavior and also the consumption patterns of tourists. because we are not talking about only green strategy from a part of companies, but we are talking about especially from the point of view of the consumer behavior, it should be pointed out such attributes as a green consumer behavior. There is a growing pressure of organizations that are operating in the field of events and tourist services in order to apply sustainable techniques because they have to consider such important factors regarding applying principles of loss reduction, reuse, and recycling. In the field of green tourism, the processes that are behind their activity has to be done, taking into account, minimizing the losses, and especially putting an accent on the use of recyclable products. If we talk about the second term that comes out after our research, we can rely on sustainable hospitality industry. So we talk about the whole industry that wants to be sustainable. And there are a lot of articles in the field that actually have behind them researches, quantitative type researches and qualitative type researches that are highlighting different aspects of the sustainable hospitality industry. It's a very important point to be highlighted that actually the players in the industry has to grow a strategic and sustainable vision in order to create value for society while they are protecting local natural and cultural resources. This is actually the main essence of sustainability in the field of hospitality industry. And of course, everything that we speak about when we are talking about sustainable hospitality industry cannot remain outside of the customer satisfaction paradigm. We have to close the cycle in a way, dealing also with sustainable consumption of hospitality services, multiple cycles of production and consumption. One of the researches made in Sardinia on a sample of 288 tourists found that actually sustainable hospitality practices generate a direct and positive link with consumer satisfaction and an indirect one, also positive, with consumer loyalty, while satisfaction mediates the impact of sustainable practices on loyalty. So it is clear the fact that actually if we are capable to deliver sustainable services, the consumer will respond positively, developing in a natural way also a certain level of loyalty. Another qualitative research in the form of in-depth interview revealed some opinions of managers involved in the specific activity of the hospitality industry, and they are talking about the need to use such instruments like adaptive reuse of hospitality-specific spaces and infrastructure. This particular technique is considered a timely method to ensure the sustainable development of hospitality. There are a lot of social, environmental, and economic benefits of applying this method because with specific and sufficient incentives that can make projects like this economically viable, there are some results that can be attained, like a higher level of cultural and historical conservation, building materials, energy, and other resources. that are becoming relevant to the demolition and construction process, because reusing is a kind of putting the potential of different types of resources to the maximum and making this process very sustainable. If we talk about the main concept of our paper, hospitality, green supply chain management, the supply chain management itself, it's a very complex concept, and it deals with a lot of factors that actually are influencing this idea of chain. We are starting from the point, the zero point of production, and we are going and finding resources, etc., and we are going towards the consumption field. If we try to define a little green supply chain management, it was defined as being a kind of organization philosophy able to offer competitive advantages for the specific organization based on high product and high services quality features, a minimum waste policy, a zero pollution approach, and of course a high return of investment and a better image on the market. So there are essential elements that are giving us a clear image about the green feature of the supply chain management in this field. Of course, this concept has a strong relationship with internal management practices regarding hospitality organizations. This is revealed by the fact, for example, that in a research conducted on 269 respondents that have been hotel managers in the hospital industry in Vietnam, the results have shown that the management of the internal environment has a significant impact on the external environment and, of course, on the image of the destination. That's another important concept in hospitality industry, the destination concept and the image of the destination. It can be very close related to the image of the touristic company itself or the image of the resort. When we are dealing with green supply chain management, we also have to take into consideration the management of the destination. In our case, in this particular field, talking about a green type of management also for the destination. Another idea that we have considered that is very interesting is that in the context of the present pandemic situation, the possibility to manage actually a sustainable supply chain in the field of hospitality has become almost a dream, because we have in the context of the pandemic a very strong negative effect that was accounted for almost every type of touristic services all around the world. So it is really a global crisis, is not a regional crisis or a local crisis. Regional and local crises in tourism in general have already been in place, but not such a crisis that actually affected all the movement of persons and companies and everything all around the world. In order to diminish the very negative effect of pandemic, top managers from three different hotel chains are highlighting several managerial approaches regarding relationship with government. It should be like financial incentives coordination, labor field coordination, market demand coordination, also relationship with tour operators, coordination within the supply field, and of course relationship with competitors, coordination from the point of view of demand and regulations. Maybe it's for the first time the level of this industry, a kind of another type of strategies has to be put in place in order to deal with the immense pressure and the negative outcome of the pandemic. This being the main area that the management of a hotel can dream to to put together in order to obtain a viable strategy. Myself and another team of researchers last year in the summer of 2020, we have conducted a research, qualitative research, on managers of hotels from Armenia. And in the in-depth interview, the results, the research itself wants to show how it's possible to find some solution of competitivity, even in this context of the pandemic. And a lot of the managers have agreed that specific measures regarding anti-COVID operational processes and so on, some measures that can give a kind of psychological comfort to the customers have been put in place. And another important idea, it was that maybe in this field, in the field of tourist organizations, maybe is one of the strategy is to be part of some bigger clusters. So if the government or the state put in place some strategy, national strategy with development of clusters in the field, maybe the organizations inside the cluster can help each other with supportive resources and so on in order to carry on in this field that was highly affected by the crisis. If we talk about sustainable orientation in the field, it has to be done also from the point of view of a relationship between intellectual capital, leadership in the organization, quality of the services, the supply chain itself, and the impact of the hotel and the strategy. Such a relationship actually was tested on 84 high-end hotels in Greece. And the results of the study bring into the light the idea that a high level of leadership excellence has a positive influence at the level of intellectual capital. And the proper implementation of leadership has a positive effect on the quality of the service, hotel impact on the market, and specific decisions that are implementing the hotel strategy. Superior leadership actually can contribute to the efficiency of the hotel from the point of view of the integration within the supply chain. Because if the individual management of a hotel, for example, if doesn't have the clues and it doesn't have the strategic view in order to make the hotel capable to integrate itself in a bigger supply chain, things are not going well. Another important topic in our research is hospitality green human resource management. If we try to define it a little, ecological human resources management can be defined as the totality of human resources practices that promote the sustainable use of the company resources by increasing the awareness and commitment of staff in relation to solving environmental problems. So we are talking about internal culture of the company that is stressing out especially the involvement of the staff in dealing with the problems also from the environmental part. So the staff itself becomes conscious about the importance of a green strategy. We are not talking only the efficiency itself of the human resource management, but we are talking about an entire inside culture of the company that it's oriented toward the green problems, and it's capable to give to every individual in the company a proper idea of its role within the whole process to make the whole company greener and to have a sustainable strategy. And of course, this kind of management involves different activities that are aligned with the three pillars of sustainability that we all know. I mean, environment, society, and economy. In the moment, then, we are speaking about putting into work green principles within human resource management. Studies in the field indicate that in this context, employees are more willing to actively support environmental practices when managers in the next higher echelon are also engaged in such practices. So we can see like a transfer of responsibility from the manager to the immediate staff that is dealing with the manager. So in this way, subsequently on stages, the organizational culture that is oriented towards sustainability can be put in place. Only if at every level of management, the staff, the operational staff, is seeing actually the same kind of orientation. In the final of our paper, we have been highlighting some future research direction. Very specific, we can talk about the subsequent literature review effort that can highlight the current changes that took place at the level of empiric practice and theoretical conceptualization in the field. Because after the pandemic crisis and in this very uncertain future that we have in front of us, we can assume that the practices inside the field are very challenging. And we are thinking about some qualitative type research that can explore perceptions of managers from the industry regarding sustainable practices and optimal ways to manage a green supply chain. Besides their own relationship between their organization and the market, all this effort could bring some new ideas effectively how we can do in the new conditions of pandemic, how actually we can do in order to obtain sustainability on the long run and to put at work this green supply chain management. Thank you. You don't have the microphone, Daniela.
Okay, sorry. Thank you very much, Daniel. Very interesting your paper. It's a very interesting content analysis. It's a depth analysis of literature review, literature about this topic. And I want to congratulate you and your team, Petronella, and with this occasion I want to say hi to Claudia, that it was very very
Claudia, put your microphone.
Yes, very good colleagues of us in Spirul Haret University, but now he moved to Economic Institute.
It's a button in the left on down on the page. You have the first button on the left, and you should press it and activate the microphone.
It seems that we must work more at this relation between us and machine and new technology.
In order to be sustainable.
It seems that we must be more friendly and we must work more here. We must work with this, with robots in the future and so on.
We have to be very close friends with the computer. The computer has to be our friend.
Yes, with computer we work, but we must be friends with clouds, with machine learning, with robots, with the other technologies. Please, if you have an answer for my colleague, Daniel.
We are welcome any question in the field. It was an idea that popped up spontaneously to our research group. we really like it because actually it's a very complex field. You can see we are not talking about only one concept. There are 6-7 concepts, and every concept in the field has its own ramifications. So it's a lot of work to do in the field of research if we start a project on this. And taking account of the qualitative type research that I have done it last year, I was thinking to repeat it in a way, but moving towards the sustainable green supply chain management idea. Mm-hmm.
Hi, I have Claudia.
Hi. Sorry. Hi, nice to see you, Claudia.
And nice to see you. And, I like to
and that we thank meet you. It.
Yes. Thank you, Spiro Haret University, to thank you, my dear colleagues, for the opportunity to take part in this conference. And I want also to thank my colleague Daniel for presentation and the collaboration in writing and presentation this paper.
Yes.
I'm glad to see you, and I hope we'll see in future not only online but face to face.
Yes.
So please.
I have a little curiosity about this research, because you present so many best practices. If you saw in this vast literature that you studied, and I am curious, which best practices do you think that is appropriate now for our context to be applied? And if you think that a transnational green hospitality chain can be a solution for improving the supply hospitality chain in Romania and management, because we can learn best management practices, and we can apply in this transnational collaboration. I don't know.
So for the first part of the question, I think the most appropriate way to see things and actually to do things is to have a strategy combining the principles of green and sustainability with the idea. This is one of the most important ideas in the last 20 years in the marketing field, if I can say, because I am a marketing specialist. Okay. The idea of sustainable consumption behavior. And it's very interesting, because we are not dealing only with the effort of different organizations in the field of services or producers of products to do things in a sustainable way. I mean, to use sustainable resources and to obtain sustainable products, okay, with minimum zero pollution and etc. We are dealing with a kind of other type of consumption culture that actually is based on some inner values of the consumers that are aligned with ideas of sustainability. And one of the most preeminent definitions of sustainable marketing, recently I have a discussion on this scientific topic with some colleagues from Bucharest University Economic Studies, and they say, every kind of marketing effort has to be sustainable by its definition. Marketing is sustainable, but is not like this. When we are talking about the concept of sustainable marketing, we are dealing with this idea: how to educate the consumer,
yes,
to learn the future generations of consumers to be also sustainable. And how am I educating myself now as a consumer to transmit this set of values to the next generations of consumers and to really have a process of sustainable consumption over time? So it's a very interesting topic, using marketing techniques and the marketing strategy, how to educate consumers now to understand the real dimension of a sustainable consumption and to perpetuate it over time to the next generations, because this is the main essence of sustainability. We are dealing with multiple generations in time. Okay, so it's a very interesting topic. So I think also in the field of hospitality and the touristic industry, the problems has to be the same. We are now facing such a tremendous challenges from a part COVID crisis. We are talking about a big change of the paradigm of consumption on different layers. Some of the aspects, we specialists itself, we are not able to see all the big picture until now, and we can't see clearly in the future, in the short future. Okay, how's going to be next in terms of the of this paradigm of consumption? But I think the solution also in this field is to orient this consumer. For example, we have been in place with another research regarding the idea, is possible that the rural touristic services to become a solution in the context of COVID? And we have done a research on Romanian consumers, and the answers are pretty much like this. Many of them has choose to make holidays only in the field, national field of Romania, and in the places that we are talking about sustainable rural touristic services. Okay, so they are not going abroad and not going to the classical spots of touristic services. They are reorienting their own consumption culture in the national level towards these rural touristic services. Okay, it's very interesting trend. And as you told about the possibility
the second, because we must fit in time.
Yes,
sorry, Daniel, very interesting things.
No problem. So the idea is, I truly believe that in the moment that a big tour operator, for example, wants to integrate different actors along the chain, he is able to do it. But this is my personal opinion and of my colleagues, of course, with the help of some governmental and implication. Okay, so maybe countries are on the verge, on the point to shake hands in the field of tourism, to build together some programs that are using main actors in the field, from the private field, but also with their own implication, other type of implication from until now. I think they really need it.
Yes.
To break up a little bit the boundaries and to think globally about this crisis, because this crisis in the tourism industry is really a global crisis.
Yes, indeed, indeed.
I'll be very short. I want to add that it's very important not only to educate the client towards green practices, but also to improve effort to educate the staff toward green practices, and also to stimulate them to adopt such practices.
Yeah.
Yes, indeed. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Greetings to Petronella. It's next to you. She supports you.
Unfortunately, no. It's with a little member of the family.
Okay. Thank you very much, Daniel.
Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Yes. We pass to the next presentation. And I we pass to the production of electricity from renewable energy sources in the Republika of Srpska. Present authors Velinka Tomic and Svetlana Angelic. Sorry if I don't pronounce correctly your name. from Regulatory Commission for the Energy of the Republic of Srpska, Information Technology School. Please, the screen is yours. Oh, we can't hear you. The mic is not. Okay.
Professor Veliki, please try to push your first button from the left on the down side of your screen.
Do you hear me?
Yes.
Now? Yes. 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 Hello, yes. Again.
Yes.
Yes.
I found that magical button.
Yes.
But that type of button. This my problem was with button on my keyboard. No, that's okay.
Oh,
it's
okay. Yes. So. Because I heard earlier. And after that, something happened again with your mic.
So, my name is Valinka. I'm from Trebinje, Bosnia and Herzegovina, and the Republic of Srpska entity of Bosnia and Herzegovina.
Yes, yes, it's a part of Bosnia and Herzegovina. Yes.
I prepared one short presentation, and let me to share my screen with you if I am able to do that. Just a second. And
perfect.
Can you hear this? Yes, I
yes.
Think.
Okay.
Yes, it's okay.
Just a second. I can't hear see you, but I think you all of you can see me and my presentation now in
yes,
this moment.
Yeah.
Yes.
So
it's okay.
What we have here, my paper is dedicated to production of electricity from renewable energy sources in the Republic of Srpska. But first of all, I would like to say something about renewable energy sources at all. Now, these days, in all medias, we can hear something about call-out phase, something about electricity prices, something about greenhouse effects, and all of these terms are related, are in some kind of relationship, and are and they're related to the our climate changes in and the health of our planet. I will start with some facts. Greenhouse gases are guilty for the global warming of our planet, of the Earth. These gases are in 99% consequence of human activities. Which human activities? Transport area, electricity production, agriculture, industry, etc. So these gases trap heat and make the planet warming. On the right side of this slide, we can see changes in the temperature, global temperature, since 1880 until 2020. So what we can see here, Earth's surface temperature has risen about 1.18 degrees Celsius during the last century,
And most of the warming occurred in the past 40 years. 2016 was the warmest year on record since 1880. Consequences of this are warming of ocean, shrinking ice sheets, decreased snow cover, sea level rise, etc. Because of all of these facts, we have a lot of international agreement signed. Among them, Paris Agreement since 2015, or Kyoto Protocol, or agreement from Copenhagen, etc., etc. The European countries adopted European Green Deal as a set of politics with the aim of making the European Union climate neutral in 2050. This plan involves reduction of greenhouse gas emission around 50% in 2030 compared with 1990 levels. In this graph, we can see the years and countries in which year every country will stop with coal production electricity from coal. So what we can hear in this picture, we can hear that only Germany will finish their coal phase out in 2038. All other countries will finish with coal until 2030. Four countries already finished with coal. They are coal free. These days, Portuguese was the fourth country that are coal, which are coal free, after Belgium, Austria, and Sweden. But some facts about polluting in Europe are really interesting, because in this picture we can see power plants from my country, from Bosnia and Herzegovina. What we have here? 8 of the 10 most polluting coal power plants in the Europe are from Western Balkan countries. In 2016, Serbian power plant Kostolac B became the most notorious sulfur dioxide polluter. The second place takes Ugljevik power plant from the Republic of Srpska. According to the same report, Gatsko, the second power plant from Bosnia and Herzegovina from the Republic of Srpska, takes also the second place by emissions of particulate matter in 2016. These two plants, Kostolac B and Ugljevik from the Republic of Srpska, account for half of all the SO2 pollution from coal plants in the Western Balkan region. These two plants alone are responsible for around 25% of all coal SO2 emissions in the European Union and Balkan together. In the Western Balkans, there are 16 outdated coal power plants that threaten public health by producing enormous amount of air pollution, impacting people not only in the region, but in European Union and beyond. Every year, they cause 300 premature deaths, 800 causes of lung problems in children, and other chronic illnesses, costing both health system and economy. What we have here? We have 16 Western Balkans power plants and the European Union. 20 times and 16 times these 10 polluting plants are bigger polluter than other thermal power plants from the European Union. Among them, Ugljevik, which is located in the east of Bosnia and Herzegovina near the Serbian and the Croatian border. This plant started to operate 33 years ago. Power plant, with their toxic emission, caused 635 premature deaths, 494 hospital admissions, etc. in 2020. So, relatively small plant with 300 megawatts installed capacity emits unimaginable amounts of dangerous sulfur dioxide, 127,000 tons per year. If I say, just a second, I will turn back. Balchatov from Poland is one of the biggest power plants in Europe, around 5,000 megawatts installed capacity. This power plant takes ninth position, 5,000 megawatts. And Ugljevik, with 300 megawatts, takes the second position. Can you imagine that? So, we have very small power plants, but we have a big polluters. According to Bosnia and Herzegovina National Emission Reduction Plan, Ugljevik's emissions should have been cut down to 9,000 tons per year, since 127,000 to 900,000. So, if we not do that, we will face with poverty, energy poverty, because of taxation for production electricity from coal. In this moment, the Republic of Srpska produces electricity from different sources. We have three thermal power plants. Two of them, Gatsko and Ugljevik, are members of public utility Elektroprivreda of Republic of Srpska. And one of these three is Stanari, private companies. But they produced around 70% of all electricity in the Republic of Srpska. 5,287 gigawatt hours. We have three big hydropower plants, 44 small hydropower plants, and just three biomass or biogas power plants, and 97 small solar power plants. Only 2,020 gigawatt hours comes from the renewable energy sources, or just 27% of all production. So, renewable energy sources and efficient cogenerations created a legal framework for support of electricity production from renewable energy sources and efficient cogenerations. The incentive system is based on two types of incentives: feed-in tariffs and feed-in premiums. The Republic of Srpska support the production of electricity from renewable energy sources, but we have only 238 gigawatt hours produced from these sources that we support. A slight increase of the share of power generated from renewable energy sources is in place now. Production of the electricity from the renewable energy sources depends on the hydrology, but also on the operational readiness of all capacities. The fact is that in our consumption, 49% on our consumption of the electricity, 49% is electricity from renewable energy sources. That's good for us because we are exporter of electricity. During decades, we exported
Sorry, do you have a problem? No. Okay. It was a little interruption. Please continue.
Okay. I'm here.
Maybe in the internet it's not so good. Please.
Probably. Just a second. Total power electricity production realized in small hydropower plants in the incentive system amounts to 214 gigawatt hours, which is annual production of these power plants on mandatory purchase of electricity at the end of 2020 was granted to 97 solar plants. With a little bit, I can say, small amount of megawatts, on just 11 megawatts, and planned 14 gigawatt hours annual production. In 2020, solar power plants produce 11 gigawatt hours, which represents 83% of the planned annual production. Only three biomass plants with 2 megawatts of the installed power produce only 20 megawatt hours, or 12% planned annual production in 2020. This is some kind of facts. I don't know that by heart. Because of that, I must read. So what we have now? BNDH has developed, Bosnia and Herzegovina has developed many documents dedicated to reducing greenhouse gases. Among them, National Emission Reduction Plan in 1980. And following the Paris Agreement, nationally determined contribution of Bosnia and Herzegovina for the period 2020-2030. District heating, building, transport, industry, agriculture, forestry, and waste are critical sectors for reducing greenhouse gases. In the spring of 2021, this year, BNDH updated NDC with the plan to cut greenhouse gas emissions for 33% by 2030 and almost 66% by 2050, compared to 1990 level. How we can do that? I put some action from these nationally determined contributions. And we can see we plan to install mini hydropower plants, to install wind farms, to install photovoltaic modules, to install the equipment for power generation from methane, from 2 underground mines. And another action that should give us fulfilling of the aim from these our agreements. But in the Republic of Srpska, Abar, which is under construction, all others power plants are just in process of getting some kind of improvements and nine megawatts hydropower plant Buk Biela with almost 100 megawatts, hydropower plant Foča, 44 megawatts, hydropower plant Paunci with almost 44 also megawatts. And we have solar power plant Trebinje with a installed capacity of 100 megawatts and average production of 147 gigawatt hours per year. And wind power plant Hrgut with installed capacity of 48 megawatts and average production of 126 gigawatt hours per year. Definitely, Republic of Srpska must increase the share of renewable energy sources in total electricity production in the next decade. However, what is the potential of Republic of Srpska in the field of renewable energy sources? Water streams and solar definitely, but we have also plans with some kind of wind farm. Waste from timber industry, firewood, municipal waste, cattle breeding and energy crops, all of these could be a great source of energy in the Republic of Srpska. To conclude, somebody said the amount of sunlight that strikes the Earth's surface in an hour and a half is enough to handle the entire world's energy consumption for a full year. Solar energy is accessible everywhere. Wind and solar investment should be explicitly linked to closing coal plants. Only wind and solar give the full benefits of coal phase out in the terms of jobs, investment, energy self-sufficiency, cheap energy, clean air, and reduced CO2 emissions. Although there is a significant energy potential in the Republic of Srpska, utilization depends on investment opportunities. Although sun and wind are recognized as the best energy sources in the future, the technology of production energy from the sun and wind is still expensive for us in the Republic of Srpska. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for a very interesting research on greenhouse gas emission and renewable energy. If you have questions, please, you can ask.
Your paper is very, very interesting, and please accept my invitation to publish your paper in my journal. In fact, I will give you on email a link to my journal, and if you want to publish it, you have to upload it on my website of the journal. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Pleasure is mine.
Yes, I hope that you can reach the target.
We'll accommodate all the papers, all the good papers, in fact. Thank you.
Yes, we have this journal of our university, and it is a very good journal. Yes, I hope that Bosnia and Herzegovina to reducing the greenhouse gas emission, because with the target who proposed it, I think that maybe if we are the member of the EU, and that's why we have a precise target on this aspect. And I hope that you succeed to pass to the renewable energy in spite of the fact that it's very expensive and there are a lot of doing in this direction.
Yeah, but in this moment we will face with energy poverty because taxation system will be really brutal. Our production from fossil fuels, from coal, will be under taxation, and our electricity will be really wouldn't be cheap like now in this moment, and will be expensive, and too expensive for households. We will face with poverty in a field of the energy, and in that moment, all our fears will be our reality. We will face with another problems, with losing of jobs, with environment problems, with health problems, with everything. Electricity is necessary.
Yes, indeed, but the passing to renewable in energy and sustainable and green environment is also a big necessity for us, for all of us, and maybe that's why it must be including some action not very
popular, maybe.
Yes, not popular. Yes, not popular. Yes, it's the best word you can use. Not popular, and that's why, in fact, we see that the sustainable and green economy is the important topic on the EU agenda and national agenda in Romania too.
Yes, we hope we will get support from funds of European Union. Mm-hmm. And I think in Paris Agreement one of the topics was about helping other countries without funds for renewable energy sources and for transition from fossil fuels to renewable energy sources.
Yes, for this transition to be easier for you because it's it's too brusque.
Who knows? Maybe this is the last chance to be aware of what's going on around us, how we act. Will our another generation will live? I think we must bear in mind our kids and grandchildren and etc.
Yes,
their lives also.
Yes, indeed. Thank you very much for interesting presentation. And now I propose to pass to another papers, the Smart Management and Industry 4.0, providers of potential solution for improving the implementation of the operational program Human Capital. Presenter Mr. Dragos Adrian Iorga from Regional Intermediate Body for Sectoral Operational Program Human Resources Development, Bucharest. Please, the screen is yours.
Good day to
all. Please take off your paper. Veliki, please, from the screen. Thank you very much.
So good day to all of you. I'm glad to be here, and it's an honor for me to be here today together with you. Thank you for your introduction. My name is Dragoș Iorga. I am the executive director for the regional intermediate body for a sectorial program, Human Capital. The program that we are managing represents an important source of investment in employment, in education, and the fight against poverty and support for social services. As you know, Romania is confronted with important challenges on the labor market, both in the area of employment and poverty. This operational program focuses on the main priorities identified for Romania. Inside this program, we have seven priorities, and one of these priorities is priority three, jobs for all. This priority will support access to employment with a focus on unemployed and inactive people, long-term unemployed older workers, disabled and persons with lower level of education. This will entail improving their skills, facilitating the recognition of their qualifications or experience, supporting labor mobility between different regions of Romania, and assisting the participants in finding a job or setting up micro companies and small to medium enterprises among others. This is where the idea when we start, I will try to share my presentation. Let's see.
Okay.
Yeah, you see?
Okay. Not yet.
I don't know. Share.
Okay.
This is good, yeah?
Yes, we can see.
So this is the idea when we joined this partnership with the other seven partners to be part of this project, you will see later on, which improves and identify different solutions for this this problem, the main problem that we are targeting being digitalization. So regional intermediate body for sectorial operational program human resources, region Bucharest-Ilfov, implements the 4.0 ready Interreg Euro project, strengthening small to medium enterprises capacity to engage in industry 4.0. Within this project, we have a research tool, a survey, which was developed and applied, designed to provide relevant information in the field of Industry 4.0, and also to provide thematic solutions. This paper, the result of an exploratory research, aims to present the relevant characteristics, trends, and potential solutions for improving the implementation of the operational program Human Capital for the period 2014-2020. A topic that generated the need to start and implicitly to operationalize such a study. Digitalization and Industry 4.0 are becoming a reality. Automation, artificial intelligence, the Internet of Things, other advanced technologies quickly capture and analyze a multitude of data that provide many types of information. The current challenge is to change the way of thinking, training, working of economic agents, managing to create added value by digital technologies. In essence, this is also the purpose of the 4.0 Ready Partnership, this project that I told you, to achieve through collaboration at interregional regional level its main objectives, namely the preparation of small medium enterprises at all levels, entrepreneurs, managers, and staff, to adapt and make facing the challenges of the Industrial Revolution 4.0 in close connection with activities dedicated to public policy instruments that support small medium enterprises in their technological, organizational, and cultural transformation. This project is a collaboration bridge, a platform for experience exchange and joint learning between 8 partners from 7 countries: Italy, Belgium, Finland, Poland, Spain, Lithuania, and Romania. Our country is represented by our organization, like I told you, the intermediate body for Bucharest ILFO. As a description of the problem, the operational program Human Capital has opened a call, Digital Competences for Small Medium Enterprises Employees, and was launched, giving total freedom to applicants to prepare a development plan for improving small medium enterprises employees' digital competences on the following 3 categories: basic digital abilities, work-related digital abilities, and TIC specialization digital competences. Also, the European e-competence framework is mentioned in this document. The missing element here is an homogeneous approach at national level on how to assess employees' digital competencies and how to create an objective development plan. Inside this project, we made this survey, Industrial Revolution 4.0 coming to our lives, provide relevant information in the field of Industry 4.0 and also automatic solutions. We need to find a new criterion to support SMEs' digital competencies through the operational program Human Capital. We are trying to find a new evaluation criteria for the call Digital Competencies for SMEs Employees, designed to support the managing authorities of this program in evaluation and to help SMEs acknowledge the main Industry 4.0 domains to focus on their digitalization path in general and specifically for development employees' digital competencies. We have the applicant's guide for the specific call, which includes Annex 3 evaluation criteria in technical and financial selection. Within this applicant's guide, a new evaluation criterion is inserted under Category 2, effectiveness related to digital competencies for small medium enterprises. More precisely, the following text is included in the evaluation criteria. The project has added value in the subcategory, training, assessment, and certification of digital skills is provided in the following technological areas specific to Industry 4.0: social media, mobile services, cloud technologies, the Internet of Things, cybersecurity solutions, automated robots and machines, large data and data analysis, 3D printing, artificial intelligence, Bitcoin, blockchain. The idea that is that we didn't have these specific areas described, and there is no way to insert in these projects, in these applications, to be more specific in this digitalization area. Our survey, Industrial Revolution 4.0, coming to our lives, carried out at the start of this project, confirmed the major interest of respondents from I-440 domain and for digital competencies development. According to this analysis, most of the SME respondents have little moderate digital knowledge, 71%, are little moderate prepared for 4.0 revolutions challenges, 71%, and have started changing actions at the moderate level, 60%. The great majority of the respondents evaluate Industrial Revolution 4.0 as an opportunity. Very important. The most important conclusion of the study, in near future, SMEs need European Union funds attraction as main countable sources in their adapting effort to Industry 4.0. Moreover, the report showed that digitalization brings opportunities for all types of companies, including small to medium enterprises, but ensuring SMEs access to digitalization must be supported, coordinated, and monitored. The current challenge is to change the ways SMEs think, train, and work to create added value by digital technologies. Romania has many advantages, such as a high internet speed, development of the ITC sector, state-of-the-art technology already present in large production facilities, as well as specialized labor force to benefit from digitalization and Industry 4.0. The main areas for improving public policies regarding the digitalization of small medium enterprises are awarenesses of the need of small medium enterprises digitalization, appropriate technical solutions for SMEs digitalization, increasing digital skills at all levels relevant for SMEs digitalization, adequacy of digital solution chosen by SMEs to market requirements. As conclusions, we identify potential solutions for improving the implementation of operational program human capital. The action identified and proposed improved the way in which thematic calls are organized and the way that projects are selected. A new evaluation criterion for the call digital competencies for SMEs employees. The new criterion is designed to support the operational program managing authority in evaluation and to help small, medium enterprises acknowledge the main Industry 4.0 domains to focus on their digitalization path in general and specifically for developing employees' digital competencies. That's the idea of our project and our survey inside the project give to light these ideas and its potential solutions for improving the implementation of the operational capital. Thank you very much. And I'm waiting for your questions if there are some.
Thank you very much too for a very, very interesting and actual presentation. Please, my colleagues, if want to ask you a question. If not, I am very happy that to see that the preoccupation for improving the digitalization the skills in SMEs, because in an international report like DAISY, for example, we can see that the Romanian is last. It has the last place in the top of the 27 country regarding the digital skills, and this is not a good mark for Romanian as all. And I think that SMEs have a great support needs for great support to improve the digital skills of their employees, of qualified employees, because they need to work with new technologies, and they must be skilled. And if you can to tell more about that project about you spoke, in which was involved four or five countries,
and they develop
a methodology, a training methodology, and a training course for improving the digital skills of employment in SMEs, and you say that include skills, general abilities, and work digital abilities, and how deliver these courses for the SMEs online, in English, in Romanian. It was a common curricula developed for all four or five countries together, and develop in all the countries, or please.
I understand. The idea is that every partner in this project will get his own path regarding this implementation and supplying different courses, different possibilities to have courses. The idea is that we are learning from each other, we are seeking for good practices. And of course, in this project, we are sharing them as transparent as possible, meaning that we are informing each other about the situation and how to deliver these possibilities. And also, we are identifying the needs specifically from small and medium enterprises from each country, and we are sharing together in this project. And also we are continuing to identify partners and stakeholders about this needs for digitalization, and also we are trying to make some policy public policy changes, like in this application for digitalization in our program.
Okay. Yes, it wasn't piloted yet in reality. It's only as a draft of training.
But fortunately, we will have the opportunity for the next programming period, which will have much money and much financing for this digitalization program.
Mm-hmm. Yes. It's a very interesting idea, and I'm very happy.
I have a small question for our dear colleagues. What is the partnership with the higher institution education regarding this digitalization of small medium enterprises?
The partnership with higher education?
Higher education institutions.
We have a stakeholder in our project, Polytechnical University. Mm-hmm. We came with our partners when they came here in Romania. We have a meeting here in Romania, and we presented all the computer laboratories and research laboratories from Polytechnical Institute. We were there, and also we participate together with them at a conference, Revolution 4.0, including also the participation of
In this process, I think it's a very good idea to imply different higher education institutions that have resources and they have the willingness to do something for the digitalization.
For sure, we already did that. Like I told you, we have a stakeholder university, Polytechnical University in Bucharest here.
Yes, it's very interesting to involve the other institution because, of course, you need technical skills that Polytechnic Institute is the best, but involve also new model of business and general and management. Task new management task for manager for employers that can be and can be involved in marketing also and can be involved the other universities.
Yeah, and the idea is
economic.
Yeah. And the idea is first of all that these small medium enterprises, staff, managers, and employees to understand
innovation. Yes, innovation management
to understand themselves, to understand their needs, because otherwise it could be a completely mess in this financing also, because if you buy some hardware which is very very high technological and you don't need this, it must be a waste of money. I mean, you should first of all you should understand what are your needs and understand what somebody to tell you what hardware you need for that domain, specifically domain, because otherwise you should spend money with no results. I mean, you should spend more money, much money with no results. This is the idea.
Yes.
Well, in the first, of course.
Yes, very interesting. Thank you very much.
Sorry, Daniel, I wasn't here from the beginning, I want to ask Professor Jörg, I don't know if you are a professor, I think.
No.
Expert then. I want to ask if you know our vice rector with international relations, Professor Costin Lianu, because I know he has a hub who is doing that just like you are doing right now. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah, it's possible. I don't know.
He was the director of the Chamber of Commerce of Romania until I think 3 years ago, for a long time, in fact. And
our roads didn't intersect, you know.
Yes.
I'm happy to have his contact, or he. If he wants to contact me to see what we can do in this field,
mm-hmm.
Sure, yes. It's not a problem.
Because it seems interesting what we're saying here, and the same thing is doing Professor Lianu with USAHASH Pro Business Center.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay, and your paper is
combine our efforts in this,
mm-hmm.
in this field. Yeah.
All the papers are very good. I saw all the papers in this conference. They are good and very good. And I want to, to invite you, if you want to publish your papers, because you are here more than one, to publish your papers in Annals of Spirul Haiti University Economic Series. I will give you a link to upload the papers if you want to.
Thank you.
And I will publish them soon in December this mm-hmm. year. Thank you.
I'm looking forward.
Yes, we keep in touch.
Of course.
Have a nice day.
Thank you very much to all of you.
Thank you very much. Very, very interesting subject. It opens a lot of ideas. now we... I don't know if we have another paper.
It was
the last
PhD student of Professor Wilfred Wukpere, but I don't know what happened with him. Unfortunately, I have two papers in this conference, but I had no time to make, a PowerPoint presentation. I'm not in the mood to present them, as you know, Daniela, because... I had an unhappy event in my family, so I'm not in the mood to present the papers right now. But I'm here with you, and I support you as much as I can.
Yes, thank you very much.
And thank you for understanding me.
Yes, I understand you, and yes, thank you very much. Please,
sorry. We are sorry to hear that you have...
it happens, Daniel.
Yes.
You know, all of us have to be born and to die. So there's the life.
Yes, indeed. Yes, then we can close here. I thank you very much for your understanding and your very, very interesting presentations. I hope that next year to meet perhaps maybe hybrid forms, because online conferences have the facility that we come, we be present rapidly, but you see that we must be more interactive, and physically it's an other energy thing there, and I think it's more positive and more good for us, for all of us. It's a very nice weather in Bucharest. I see this sunshining day. I transmit in Bosnia Herzegovina a positive energy too, and nice to meet you. Thank you very much, all of you, for the interesting presentation. Have a nice day.
I will come with diplomas in a few days to you, you know, participation diplomas.
Oh, thank you very much.
My colleagues are working at the diplomas, and in a few days we'll have them on your emails. Thank you. Thank you.
You are amazing. Bye.
Thank you,
Elena.
Thank you
very much.
Nice to meet you all.
Bosnia.
Bye-bye.
Have a nice day. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.